you guys are up on stage because you're famous. You're famous because you have great ideas, but also because both of you are very good communicators. And I think you'd agree with me that most scientists are not very good communicators. Is that because science attracts people that are not very good communicators and allows them to be or is it because there's part of something in the scientific training process that makes people into bad communicators? And regardless of the case, how can scientific education be changed to make people that are scientists very good communicators?
Yeah, you start
I don't think... Well... I think that's unfair. I don't think that scientists as a group are bad communicators. I think there are good communicators and bad communicators in any field. I do think that the scientific establishment should recognize communication skills as a virtue. It's said, I don't know with what truth, that Carl Sagan was denied fellowship of the National Academy of Sciences because other scientists were jealous of his success as a communicator. I hope that's not true, but if it is, then that would be an indication of what could possibly be wrong. It may be that in the scientific culture there is value, prestige, kudos given to number of papers published in Nature and Science rather than, say, books selling well to the general public. So there is a prestige mismatch between what one would like to see and what is actually there. So maybe that organizations like the National Academy of Sciences and Britain, the Royal Society, and the grant-giving bodies should value communication more, because science does need public support. It's ultimately where the money comes from, after all. Scientists who really do bury themselves in ivory towers are doing their subject and themselves a disservice. But actually, if you go to conferences, scientific conferences, listen to graduate students presenting their research, many of them are brilliant at communicating. Really lucid, very clear, setting things out in the right order. This is the problem I'm faced with, these are the methods, and using imagery, using good language. There are plenty of excellent communicators among young scientists, and I think they just need encouragement to get out there and communicate.
Well, actually, I want to turn that around a little bit because, there's the large scale kudos one gets, when you're a professional, but you got to reach that point. And the interesting thing is, I do think we do a tremendous disservice and to students because we don't instill the notion of communication. And in fact, we don't explain to them that you actually, a large part of succeeding as a professional scientist is in fact your ability to communicate. I've seen, as chair of a physics department for many years, and I've seen when we hire people, how people who are in some sense equally able get, one of the things that determines sometimes whether we hire people are how well they communicate to us about their ideas. And I was on a visiting committee at MIT a few years ago, which was trying to do something really interesting. Right now, when we take our science, they were more worried more about engineering students, but it works the same way. We require them, to take some writing course, right? And the writing course is taught by some bozo they never heard of, right? I mean, from their point of view. We should start to impose the requirement of writing and oral communication as a part of our physics courses and our engineering courses. Why? Because these students view the professors of physics and engineering as their mentors. Those are the people they care about. And if they're not telling them how important to communicate it is, then if they just have to take something from column B to get their degree, it doesn't matter. So what I really think we do have to do in our educational system is make students realize and make an important part of all of the curriculum, not just the writing part, but of a physics class and an engineering class and a biology class, that oral and written communication are incredibly important. Because in fact, for engineers, it's really true that their abilities to succeed as an engineer are not so dependent upon their intrinsic abilities as engineers as later on when they work in companies, how well they can convince their colleagues and how well they can make presentations. And we really do a disservice, I think, to our students not to indicate that their success in their own field in some ways relies as much on communication as it does on their other abilities. Yeah.
I think that one of the American grant-giving bodies, it may be the National Science Foundation, at one point introduced a rule that when they gave money for a research grant, as some proportion of that of the grantee's time had to be given over to communicating their research to the general public. I forget whether, was that the NSF?
Well, the NSF, but I actually, by the way, I have to say, I mean, again, I have some problems with that, because one of the things that was required is you have people who, young people, in their very first grant application, and they're just starting, they've never taught in their lives, and they have to give their teaching philosophy, and they have to talk about their outreach efforts, and frankly, they've never done it. And it's a good thing to do, but unfortunately, I think what one finds is that people tend to put in boilerplate, and it's probably too late. I mean, it's a good place to do it, but I think it's too late to start there. I really do.
We're now, it's unfortunate, it's 4 o'clock, and we're going to have to stop, but I really wanted to give a great round of applause for you.
Thanks a lot.